Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. We begin in the name of Allah, all praise and glory be to Allah. And may His finest peace and blessings be upon His Messenger Muhammad and His family and His companions and all those who adhere to His guidance. Brothers and sisters, before I begin, I need to tell you that I cannot describe how much I have personally fallen in love with the study of the parables of the Quran in this month. And I hope you're benefiting as well, but I cannot tell you how much I have. And I hope that our benefit is not just hearing and listening and being fascinated and being entertained. And I hope I'm not the last to benefit from my words, but just know that, and know that it is extra difficult for me to decide every night what I'm not going to share. Because it's just so amazing and so endless. In any case, may Allah Azza wa Jal bless our time and our decisions. Tonight's parable is in Surah Al-Ankabut, the Surah of the Spider, 29th chapter of the Quran. And it is about the namesake of the Surah, the Ankabut itself, the spider. And ultimately, this is a parable regarding the inherent perfect might and power of Allah and the inherent powerlessness of everything else. And by extension, the wisdom and the correctness of Tawheed, of singling Him out as the ultimate source of power, and the futile, pointless, preposterous notion of Shirk, of setting equals to Allah Azza wa Jal subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَثَلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ. Allah says, the example of those who equate others with Him, deem others as equivalent to Him, كَمَثَلِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ, is like the example of the spider اتَّخَذَتْ بَيْتَ, when it constructs its house. وَإِنَّ أَوْهَنَ الْبُيُوتِ لَبَيْتُ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ, and certainly the weakest of houses is the house of the spider. لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ, if only they would realize. So this parable is to help us realize the reality check of Allah's great power and the utter powerlessness of everything else. Think about it. What is the house of the spider? Obviously, the house of the spider is the spider web. What is the house of the spider? It is flimsy threads. It does not offer any shelter from an enemy attacking. It does not offer any protection from the elements, the cold, the wind, the heat, nothing at all, right? Therefore, it doesn't even deserve to be called a home. The supposed home or house of the spider is not a home at all. It's just a name that is undeserved. And likewise, throughout the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal says, all of these false entities you rely on, إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا أَسْمَاءً سَمَّيْتُمُوهَا, it is nothing but asma, names, labels that you called at you and your forefathers. So in reality, you're just worshipping the label. It's imaginary. It's not actually providing you with anything. It is flimsy, it is weak, it is unreliable. It is like, as Ibn al-Qayyim said, you take the skin of the onion, you know, the onion peel, the very thin, almost see-through skin of the onion, and you call it meat. It will not nourish you. Changing the name won't do anything. And so this is the first thing, that all of the idols or the ideas, the presumed power of anything else is pathetic and vulnerable and unstable and bound to disappoint and crumble. The second reflection that we can perhaps stop at is that the house of the spider is not just unqualified to be called a house. It is actually a trap, isn't it? You know, they say that the spider doesn't even necessarily live on the web. It goes to more reliable areas, like between two rocks or something, and it has like a trap line. Now we know this from like modern observation and stuff. When the fly lands, the fly gets trapped, it feels the vibration, it runs to eat it, right? It looks like it's a trap. Likewise with shirk. Shirk has this false promise of security, of refuge, of sanctuary, of fulfillment. You will never have security outside, away from Allah Azza wa Jal. You will never have inner peace distant from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's actually a horrific experience to get caught in the trap of the spider web and await for the spider to get to you and eat you alive. Similarly, like the other ayah that says, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ, whomever sets equals with Allah, confuses Allah with others, فَكَأَنَّمَا خَرَّ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ, it's like they fell from the sky. Horrific experience. You might die from a heart attack, Allah forbid, on the way down before you actually crash. You can, and you will not really have much chance at survival through shirk, right? The same way you don't have much survival when you fall for the trap or you fall out without a parachute or something. Yes? So it is a trap. And recognizing it as a trap is a great favor from Allah Azza wa Jal for us. This you know, illusion of power. What can and can't we share here? You know, our job, our test in life is what? To make sure we never allow anything to crowd the uppermost station in our heart, Tawheed. Yes? Because then you are not differentiating between your firmest handhold and between a flimsy thread. You know, elsewhere in the Quran, Allah said that openly. He said, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. Whomever rejects all other supposed entities, supposed sources of power, and believes in Allah. What makes a mu'min so resilient, so strong, so stable? It's not that you believe in Allah. It's not even that you worship Allah. It is that you've rejected all else but Allah. It's that sword of yours where you say, لا إله إلا الله. Because you know, if you only worship Allah, but you still believe there are others that are inherently powerful out there, you will always be haunted by what if I'm not pleasing the other God right now? Whether they're my boss or some supernatural being, right? That is the problem. That is the trap. And so our test in life is to differentiate always between the flimsy thread and the firmest handhold. That's our job. You know, why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed for illusions of power to exist so that this test would be a real test? Do you know Surah Al-Ankabut, the chapter of the spider, begins with what? أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا. Do people think they're going to be left alone to say we believe in the one true God and they will not be tested? No, we're going to test you. Then it speaks about the illusion of power. And are you going to push through and never fall short of seeing through that? And the surah ends with saying what? وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا. If you keep those that strive to do this, strive in our path, strive for our sake, we will guide them. You know, it is just like in Surah Muhammad, which is also the Surah of Qital, of combats and fighting. Allah says, ذَلِكْ وَلَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ لَانْتَصَرَ مِنْهُمْ. That will be sort of the dynamic, believers, disbelievers, shayateen, all of this, right? And if Allah wished, He could have defeated them all. وَلَكِنْ لِيَبْلُوَ بَعْضَكُمْ بِبَعْضٍ. But He wants to test you one with another. So this is our test in life. To separate between the flimsy thread, the pathetic, to see through it all, and to hold on to Allah Azza wa Jal, no matter what. It's all about to collapse, to see it that way. You know, interestingly, I was reflecting just today on, think of the Zionist project. For how long they've been weaving their web of allies and lies and conspiracies and networking, and it is all collapsing right in front of them, and they're making, in their scrambles, one uncalculated sort of mistake after another. May Allah accelerate the collapse. But think about it. They're getting caught completely off guard. Or even look in your own personal life. Shaitan is casting web after web of temptations on us all year round, shackling us with these things, and in an instant, Allah chains him up and says, start over in Ramadan. This is Allah Azza wa Jal. The last thing I will say very quickly, or else I'm going to be all over the place tonight, is that some of the scholars said that the spider very rarely lives in a colony. It is imaginable. They may have colonies, but in general, spiders build their webs alone, away from the rest, and they're solitary creatures. And likewise with shirk. With shirk, when everyone's sort of making up their own false god, they're going to sort of build their allegiance and their enmity based on whether you agree with my God. So this is why without the unity of Allah, you will never have the unity of humanity. Through shirk, even humanity, the social fabric, the camaraderie, the fraternity, will be in shambles as well. Not just the individual, not just his strength, not just his psychology, not just his spiritual purity. The relationships will never work without tawheed. They will never be. And so, you know, Malcolm, rahimahullah, used to always say this. He used to say that Malcolm X, Malik Shabazz, rahmatullahi alayh, when he went, you know, to war with the racism problem. He said, the Americans need to understand that nothing has the solution to racism except what? Islam. Nothing. Because, you know, what are all the turf wars, the territorialness of all human, what is it? It is because you are your own inherent God. You're imagining yourself, the illusion of you being God. So everyone's got to be like me, and everyone's pulling in their own direction. But when we all submit to Allah, one creator, on this one planet, we are one family, only through that can the ego sort of be reeled in and the unity of humanity be realized. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Jazakallahu khairan.